Hello. First off, let me just say this isn't meant to be any kind of anodising how-to. It's more of a what did. I'm not any kind of expert. I've only done maybe a dozen small parts over 3 years or so. Whilst I was getting the stuff together to have another go, I thought I'd share my experience from a UK perspective, as a lot of what's out there is by US authors. This is the piece I'm going to anodise. It's going to be part of a puller that I'm working on. I'm not sure what grade the aluminium is, and it remains to be seen how well it'll work. The first thing to say is that unlike painting or other coatings, anodising won't hide anything. If your part's not perfect but you're happy with it, carry on. But remember, the way it looks now is the way it'll look in the end. I'm aiming for a satin brushed look for this part. Here I'm using 400 grit wet and dry with a bit of WD-40 to bring all the surfaces to a similar looking finish. I'll put the part to one side for now and wash my hands. I knew I'd left the gloves out for something. Before I do anything with any chemicals, here's a disclaimer. Sodium hydroxide and sulphuric acid can both be very dangerous. You need a tidy space to work, gloves, eye protection and old clothes. Trust me on the old clothes. The acid's cost me 2 pairs of jeans so far. When making up the solutions, always add the chemical to the water, not the other way around. There's various confusing rhymes out there that are supposed to help you remember this, but this is how I see it. Chemicals are dangerous. Hungry sharks are dangerous. Think of the chemicals as hungry sharks. A drop of water into a tank of concentrated chemicals is like a drop of blood into a tank of concentrated sharks. They're gonna go berserk, possibly covering you in a shower of boiling sharks. On the other hand, if you drop one shark into a tank of blood, you're probably gonna be okay. I'm using deionized water for this film. I've used reverse osmosis water and that worked fine. I've not tried distilled. Some people reckon soft tap water is good enough. I usually use an etch bath made with 2% sodium hydroxide. This is fairly easy to get hold of and can usually be found in the cleaning aisle of the supermarket. The upside is the parts are made really clean, which is crucial. The downside is any highly polished finishes tend to be made a bit dull. Dilutions are by weight, not volume, and my storage bottles hold 2.5 litres. For water, 2.5 litres weighs 2.5 kilograms. 2.5 kilos is 2,500 grams. And 2% of 2,500 grams is 50 grams. With 50 grams of my final weight accounted for, I'll need 2,450 grams of water. From this point on, it's gloves and glasses all the way. I start by weighing out the water. Then I weigh out the caustic soda. Remember, the reaction is exothermic. Always add the chemical, a little at a time, to the water. If the bottle starts to feel warm, leave it for a few minutes to cool before adding some more chemical. Next comes the anodising solution itself. The first time I had a go at anodising, I tried sodium bisulfate on the grounds that it's meant to be safer and easier to obtain. There's a link in the text to a site where they've had good results with this, but I couldn't get it to work. Bear in mind though, I had no previous experience to back me up, and I used the cheapest sodium bisulfate I could find, which could have been icing sugar for all I know. Most American instructions begin with, go to your local auto parts store and get a quart of battery acid. You'll struggle with that in the UK. Battery electrolyte is available, but it's not common. You certainly won't get it in Halfords. Anyhow, by chance, I came across a type of drain cleaner that's 91% sulfuric acid in a local DIY place. It was just on the shelf, not even behind the counter, no ID required. I was a bit surprised given that you can't even buy pointy things in the UK until you're 18. As before, I'm mixing by weight, not volume. I want to end up with a total of 2,500 grams of solution. 15% of that needs to be acid, which is 2,500 times 0.15, which is 375 grams. Now my drain cleaner is only 91% acid, so I'll need a bit more than 375 grams. In fact, it'll be 412 grams. I've already got 412 grams towards my 2,500 grams of finished solution. So I'll need 2,500 minus 412 equals 2,088 grams of distilled water. First, I weigh out the distilled water. Then I weigh out the acid. It looks like I need to restock as I'm just shy on the 412 grams I calculated, but a slightly weaker mix shouldn't have too much effect. To start with, my water's at room temperature at about 18 degrees C. Remember, add the acid to the water, and add a bit at a time, keeping an eye on the temperature. Here I've added about a third of the acid and got about a 10 degree rise. I added the rest of the acid gradually over the next quarter of an hour or so, keeping an eye on the temperature. I was mainly trying to avoid the bottle going soft with the heat and collapsing under its own weight. Interestingly, it goes from purple to yellow when it's diluted, and it goes clear the first time it's used for anodising. I've every faith in the bottles that I use and I've never had one leak, but just in case, I keep the mixed solutions inside extra tubs when they're not being used, and I store them on the bottom shelf. Seems like this way it would cause least mess if one were to let go. The last solution to make up is the dye. There's plenty of options for dye. Lots of people like RIT liquid fabric dyes, but I can't get those locally, and online they're close to the cost of metal dye, so I haven't tried them. This type of Dylon is what all my local shops stock. I've tried a couple of colours with zero success. There's a lot of stuff in the pouch, certainly more than just a few grams of dye. It's probably great for fabric, but it's rubbish for metal. I've also tried some old-fashioned Dylon cold water dye that I picked up at a car boot sale. Ebony black, emerald green and tangerine orange all worked to a greater or lesser degree. This is a piece of scrap dyed with the black. This is the orange, which has worn off quite a bit. And this is the green, which didn't work too well because the panel wasn't cleaned properly. I've found the cold water dyes don't like being stored for months on end. Over time, little bits form in the solution, which spoils the result. A coffee filter will clean it up, but it's a messy business and I wouldn't recommend it. If you've time to experiment, there are places reporting success with fountain pen ink, inkjet printer ink, and various other things. This will be my first time using proper anodising dye. The instructions say 1 gram to a litre should give good results. My dye tub holds 750 mils, so I need 3/4 of a gram of dye, which is just a pinch. So that's all the solutions ready to go. The next thing is the power supply. Small parts like mine don't need anything very powerful, and this one will give 5 amps at 24 volts. For my first attempt, I used it as is, but after doing some research, I found out that a constant current supply gives the best results, so I built this add-on unit. It's just a banggood switching regulator module put in a box. It means I can set the target current and leave it to look after itself, instead of having to manually fiddle with it right the way through. The final bit of homemade equipment is this magnetic stirrer. It's just a little motor, an eBay speed control module, and a nylon disc with 2 magnets glued into it. These are called fleas and come from China for not much money. I admit this is a bit overkill, but it does help to stop bubbles sticking to the surfaces. I make the cathodes from thick aluminium foil, cut from these party platter plate things. They last for a few goes, but are basically disposable. Lead's supposed to be a good choice for cathodes, but it's surprisingly hard to get hold of. I use 2 or more large cathodes, depending on the shape of the part, to try, within reason, to make all the paths between the electrodes similar. My reasoning goes like this. If I used a single post-type cathode, the nearest end to the part would initially see all the current, and as the oxide layer was built up, an area further up the part might offer the lowest impedance and see some action. But it's anybody's guess if the opposite end would anodise at all. In order to set the power supply, I need to know the surface area of the part. I'll just treat it as a rectangular bar and ignore the holes. That gives me 2 surfaces of 11.4 by 0.9. two surfaces of 11.4 by 2.2, and two surfaces of 0.9 by 2.2. All told, that's about 74.64 square centimetres. This value is plugged into a 720 rule calculator. Entering the numbers, I get 120 minutes per mil of thickness for a current of 0.48 amps. I usually leave the amps per foot setting at a default value of 6. The electrical connection to the part is made with soft, uncoated aluminium craft wire. Where possible, I make two or more connections. The reason being, as the anodising progresses, the insulating oxide coating will build up all over the part. If contact is broken, the chances of reconnecting to that exact spot are zero. The chances of getting a good contact elsewhere could be difficult if a decent layer of oxide is already built up. I fold a big end enough to jam it into a suitable hole. The connection needs to be good mechanically as well as electrically to minimise the chances of the part falling off and having to fish around in the bottom of the acid tank to get it back. The next bit is really important. The part must be spotless. Any greasy fingerprints will be visible on the finished item. I start by cleaning thoroughly with brake cleaner until no visible dirt comes off the part. I tend to reuse gloves until they fall apart, but for this bit I use a clean pair that won't have any oil on them. The part and the aluminium connecting wire are given a final clean with MEK, and then the wire is fitted firmly into the part with a hanging loop at one end. The first chemical bath is the sodium hydroxide etch. It gets about 20 seconds or so in here, and then a rinse in clean water. Here the power supply is short-circuited and the maximum current is set to that calculated by the 720 rule. The two cathode plates are connected together and then to the power supply negative. Once the tank has been filled with the 15% sulphuric acid solution, the part is hung inside on a wooden stick, something like equidistant between the cathodes. The circuit is completed back to the power supply. After a few seconds, you can see thousands of tiny bubbles forming in the tank. Each bubble creates a minute splash of acid when they reach the surface and burst. I'd strongly recommend lightly covering the tank with the tissue or everything in the vicinity will start corroding. And that's it for 2 hours. Just come back and check nothing's gone wrong every so often. When the time's up, the power is removed and the part is thoroughly rinsed in water. Next comes the dyeing. This is optional, the part can just be left self-colour if you just want to make it a bit more corrosion or scratch resistant. Just agitate the part in the dye until it reaches the colour that you want. This is my first go with real metal dye, and I have to admit it's miles better than anything else I've used. The colour is deeper and is fully absorbed. Other dyes I've tried look okay until they're rinsed, when a lot of the intensity just washes off. The final stage is to seal the part. I'm simmering it in boiling water for about 40 minutes. Once cooled, the connecting wire can be removed and the job's finished. This is one of my better attempts, though it's still not perfect. I've got a bit of a tide mark on one side. I'm not sure what caused this. Perhaps drying the part between baths would help? To finish up, here's the part fitted in the puller that I was making. And that's it. Thanks for watching.